and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we, who fill our lives with your ideals, be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, so by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Well, I welcome you here today, and hopefully you've noticed the church in the sanctuary area has a different look. We are celebrating our 120th anniversary of organization today, the Feast of the Institution. And I do want to make sure that you all know right from the very beginning that in your song sheet, we will be reciting the National Catholic Creed, the Confession of Faith, in place of our usual Nicene Creed. And so after the sermon, when I go up and do the I Believe, please follow along here in your song sheet for this one particular Sunday for that creed. So we are 120 years young as of today, the second Sunday of March, 1897. Again, I mentioned it to the acolyte, and a young lady over here, won't mention her name, but it's Allie, and she said, were you the first priest 120 years ago? Yeah. So thank you very much, Allie, for that. But I was in the cathedral down in Scranton when I was a brand new priest back in 1985, and if you get the electronic newsletter or email, e-bulletin, you know that I was the assistant down there with Father Ray Dreda, and thank God for Father Ray. He was like, he was a fun, normal kind of guy, and he helped my transition from college life to seminary life immensely, and I wouldn't like to think about what those first days in Scranton would have been without him. He passed away this past Wednesday at the age of 58 after 20 some odd years of battling cancer. And so, you know, that's the sad part, but the blessing is that he got to see his children's children. So he was a grandfather, and so those 20 years did allow him to see that. And he wasn't sick all the time, you know, so it wasn't like 20 years of just, you know, constantly in the hospital, but he did suffer for 20 years and fought for 20 years, and his funeral will be tomorrow. One of the things about Father Ray is he had a quirky sense of humor, and he was one of these guys who could set you up and then stand back and just kind of watch and never like smile, never smirk or anything, and just watch. And you know, as well as I do, that I can't sing. As a matter of fact, right now I have kind of whispered to thee we come because this mic picks it up, and last week it was so bad I even cut it out of the FCAT video because it was just so bad. So he would set me up, because if I hear one tune, I automatically lose the previous tune. And so, you know, I was struggling with Polish, and then, do you remember the tune for Close Encounters? That da-da-da-da-da. He would go, Hanyes mi wishem. And then he would send me out the door to celebrate Mass in Polish. And I couldn't get the regular hymn in my head. I had that, Hanyes mi wishem. And the worst one of all, and I actually need Cher to help me with this because I can't even hear it right now. You know, the benediction is holy, holy, holy. And he would sing what? Uh-oh. Oh, you can't do it either? The holy?
Holy, holy, holy.
He would sing that to me in the sacristy, that other holy, holy, holy. I would go out for May devotions. The first thing you do at May devotions is intone benediction, and I would sing that instead of benediction. And we had the cathedral had this beautiful, massive, million-dollar organ with a professional, you know, this guy, Wesley James, was like this perfect organist. And I would come out and sing that, and Father Ray said he would just sit there like this. He didn't know what to do. And then Father Ray would just kind of, you know, not even smirk, just kind of watch the whole thing. But so I'm hoping that, you know, he's watching all of this from up above, and I do pray for him and his family and his parish, and I hope that he has eternal rest, and his family and his parish have the gift of peace and of hope as well. But as we do gather today to celebrate this 120th anniversary of our organization as a separate National Catholic Church, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, the martyrs, and faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins. Amen. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Show us your mercy, Lord.
Amen.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And
the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments, and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, invisible, revealed in triune power, for all time, both now, and forever.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God, you call the humble priest, Father Francis Hodder, to be your servant and to awaken your people for work in your vineyard. Grant as we observe the 120th anniversary of your call to us, that our faith may be made firm and our hearts may be kindled by the fire of a holy sacrificial love. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The lesson for this morning's Feast Day Mass is taken from the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands to heaven. He said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and steadfast love for your servants who walk before you with all their heart, the covenant that you kept for your servant my father David as you declared to him. You promised with your mouth and have this day fulfilled with your hand. Therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant my father David that which you promised him, saying, there shall never fail you a successor before me to sit on the throne of Israel, if only your children look to their way to walk before me as you have walked before me. Therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you promised to your servant my father David. But will God indeed dwell on earth? Even heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you, much less this house that I have built. Have regard to your servant's prayer and his plea, O Lord my God, heeding the cry and the prayer that your servant prays to you today, that your eyes may be open night and day towards this house, the place of which you said, my name shall be there, that you may heed the prayer that your servant prays towards this place. Hear the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray towards this place. O hear in heaven your dwelling place, heed and forgive. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I praise you, Lord, for you raised me up and did not let my enemies rejoice over me. Alleluia, alleluia. In you, Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, deliver me. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. You cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be my heart, not my lips, that I may worthily proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He takes away every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and every one that does, he prunes that it may bear even more fruit. You are already pruned because of the word that I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I remain in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit on its own unless it remains on the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me, and I in him, will bear much fruit, because without me you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me will be thrown out like a branch and wither. People will gather them and throw them into the fire, and there they will be burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Come to our hearts, please.
I am the vine, said Jesus, and you are the branches. And the selection taken from this morning's gospel according to St. John. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today we gather in parishes across the country, from right here in New England all the way to California's west coast, from down in warm Florida up to Minnesota. We worship in large cathedrals and small town churches like ours, in churches that are today worshiping in English, some in Polish, and some even in Spanish. And in all of these churches, the purple of Lent today gives way, at least on this one special Sunday, so that we can celebrate the founding of our church denomination on the second Sunday of March, 1897. A few hundred people sat in a church hall on that day in a section of Scranton called Southside, and above them, work was still in progress on erecting a church building. But on that March 14th evening, 120 years ago, all that was completed was the first floor of the church hall. Now, families had gathered together to await the arrival of a priest they once knew as their assistant pastor, but he was now a full pastor out in Nanticoke, Pennsylvania, which was about 30 miles away. They were nervous. They didn't know what to expect that night. They were already in uncharted territory, and they were considering an action that night that would drive them even farther out into the unknown. They were starting to build a church on their own, and they had no permission from anyone to do so. There was no bishop that said, you can go do this and I'll give you a priest when you're done. They had felt ignored when they voiced their concerns, and they felt powerless to do anything about it. When no one listened, they had no recourse. And that is until they decided to build their own church building. And instead of building it, taking the deed and giving it to the diocese, they would hold that deed themselves. This would be their leverage. In a church orientated from the top down, this would be their only vehicle to make sure that all of the people in the pews, that they mattered, and that their voices would be heard in the parish decisions at hand. And we need to remember that 1897 Scranton was coal country, and this was pre-Union coal country. Mining companies were encouraging immigrants to flood into the United States because they knew that this would provide them with a constant supply of workers, of men who would venture down into those mines no matter how dangerous it was down there, and that they would not complain, because if they did complain, there were 10 other guys waiting to take their jobs. We have to remember, not that long ago, just a few generations, we were a church of immigrants. Now these were men and women who only mattered for the work that they could do. They didn't really count as people. They were tools. And if the tools got broken, they were simply thrown away and replaced. You know, today, we buy cheap toasters, microwaves, televisions. When I was a kid, I remember there were repairmen who used to come into my parents' house and they would fix stuff. Now we don't fix anything. We throw them away. Think about 1897, those miners. Think about them as if they were cheap appliances more than they were people. Think about how important it was for them to be respected and to be heard, at least when they came into the house of God. You know, they were treated as less than people 6 days out of the week. But when they came into the house of God, they wanted to be respected as a child of God. These were the people who were sitting in that church hall on a Sunday evening 120 years ago, awaiting the arrival of a priest that they planned to ask to become their pastor. The families who started constructing their church on East Locust Street, they could put up a building, but to keep the traditions of Mass and sacraments alive inside of that building, for that they needed a priest, and not just any priest. Their pastor would have to sympathize with their position. He would have to work beside them. He would have to listen to their concerns and to their ideas. He would need to lead them by example and teaching and not by dictating to them. Their pastor, they would not accept as their boss. They had enough of bosses every day outside of the church who treated them terribly, and they weren't going to allow another boss to do the same thing in the church that they were building, in the church in which they came to worship Jesus, and they weren't going to come there as second-class citizens when it came to Jesus. And this is why this group of people had extended an invitation to a Father Francis Hoder to come and to meet with them. When he was their assistant pastor, he treated them as people. He organized groups to teach them not only about catechism, the Bible, and worship. He taught them about arts. He taught them about history. He taught them even about science. And he got into trouble by his pastor, he was the assistant pastor. His pastor was upset with him because he was not collecting enough money from these people because he saw how desperate they were. So instead of putting 50 cents into the basket, he said just put in the quarter because he knew that they had trouble paying their bills. And these people probably knew his story. He had run into conflicts with local religious and political authorities back in Poland because he would not tolerate their abuse of power. It got so bad that he had to emigrate to the United States of America. And we don't have good records of what happened that night in Scranton. And we do know that Father Holder accepted their invitation to become their pastor. And when he did that, he set himself up in defiance of his bishop, who had never sanctioned his move because he was an assigned pastor in Nanticoke. He had no right to simply pack up and go to another church in Southside Scranton. And because of this, Father Holder was officially excommunicated on September 29th of the very next year. And just by one of those freak happenstances of history, it was on September 29th of 1907 that Holder was consecrated our first bishop. So the whole thing went around. He got excommunicated on September 29th, and he got consecrated a bishop on September 29th. These people and this priest now look forward to the horizon rather than looking over their shoulders. As soon as they were excommunicated, it was no more about where we had been, it's where we're going to. They began to build on what they thought the church could be. Their theological reforms, which were many, clustered around the idea that God is so much more loving than he is fearful, and that creation, his good creation, is defined more by hope than by failure. And their liturgical reforms started the church moving toward a greater participation by all members of the congregation so that they could understand and more participate in the Mass. Remember, at that time, Mass was in Latin. The priest only faced that way. He was mumbling words. People were out there, maybe with a rosary. They were doing their prayers. He was doing his prayers. The language was incomprehensible. They couldn't see what was going on. Holder turns around the Mass. He puts it in the language of the people. And all of a sudden, the people could start participating more in what was going on in the mystery of the Mass. And their governance, which will take place after Mass this morning as we gather for our annual congregational meeting, embraced wholeheartedly the ideal of democracy, that every person's voice matters. If in the church, Holder said, all are baptized Christians, if in the church all are inspired by the Holy Spirit, then everyone in that church has a voice in that church. Now this is the story that we celebrate today. And this is the story that we are still writing today, or in the imagery of this morning's gospel, we are one of the branches, and Jesus is the vine, and we are all still growing. Jesus' incarnation as one of us, which really means Jesus' incarnation as all of us. Jesus' death as everyone's outcast, so that means that no one ever after is going to be God's outcast, means that God in Jesus is always going to be more than any church institution, because God in Jesus is the mystery that all of us, every single one of us, whatever you call yourself, whether you're a sinner or a saint, God loves us. Doesn't mean that he's happy with us. You all, if you're a parent, you know that when your kid messes up, you can be very disappointed with them, but you still love them. God loves us one and all, even if sometimes he's disappointed with us. But God loves us one and all. Jesus is the life-giving vine, and the churches are the branches that spread out in different and simultaneously entangled directions as part of that vine, but the branches are not the whole of the vine. Our privilege as church reaches beyond trying to explain God. We reach out in worship and the work of the church, and we actually experience God. It is his Spirit that flows through us and gives us life, just like the vine gives life to the branches, so God works through us, God is present through us. This we have now done for 120 years in our own unique way. And may Jesus continue to guide us and be with us as we hope to serve him always faithfully. And this we pray in his name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather on this, our feast of the institution, we offer you our thanks for the gift of our church and our parish. We also offer our prayers in loving memory of Frederick F. Warren, whose birthday would have been this past Friday, March 10th. It's offered by his loving wife, Teresa, and his daughters and families, Barbara, Mark, Robert, Carrie, Dan, and Ashley, and David, Allison, Ray, and Jason, and Sean. We also offer our prayers for Chester Stahelski on the 28th anniversary of his death, which was March 9th of 1989. It's offered by Mark and Barbara Stahelski. We also offer prayers for Sophia LaFleur for a speedy recovery. This is being offered by the Zara Lynch family. We offer prayers for Liz Bridgman battling cancer and raising three young girls on her own, Alex, a 16-year-old with lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, is all offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer prayers for Frank Sprosky, is offered by his brother Don, the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. We continue to offer prayers for Bishop Thomas Gannat's health, and also for the well-being and strength of his wife Catherine, is offered by myself. We offer prayers for the following for battling cancer: Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Sprosky, Maurice Lazelle is offered by myself, Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families, 2-year-old Jack Soleil is offered by Marianna Foster, and also prayers for Father Ray Trada, who passed away this past week, whose funeral is tomorrow. We pray that he may rest in peace. We also pray for the gift of faith and hope and for his family and for his parish as well. Are there any other intentions that you would like to offer? Yes.
Last week, we prayed for a girl 19 years old that fell off a horse, and she broke 7 ribs, collapsed lung, and internal bleeding. And yesterday, she finally, after 12 days, came home from the hospital.
Oh, thank God for that. Good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Holly, would you like to tell us what's going on with Sophia?
I don't know if I'm supposed to say.
Okay. So is she okay? Is she home?
I believe, yeah, she's home.
Okay.
She had a seizure.
Oh, she did?
And so she's now home resting.
Okay. So Sophia is EJ and Ann's daughter. So we'll say a special prayer for Sophia. Any other prayers? Lord, for these and all of the other intentions that we keep in the privacy of our thoughts, we ask you, Lord, also to bless each and every one of us here gathered, and to be with those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in God, the Father, the source of all existence, eternal truth, love, and justice. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Savior and spiritual regenerator of the world, who is the messenger of God, of one substance with him, he guides humanity in the humble woman Mary. I believe that this Nazarene master, through his divine life, word, teachings, and suffering death, became the spark that enkindled a new life of humanity. A life which begins in power, strength, and fullness in knowledge of God, in loving Him, and in fulfilling His divine will. I believe that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, rules the world, that from the Holy Spirit flows grace, which brings it to pass that when a person cooperates with it, he or she will find eternal happiness in God. I believe in the Holy Christian Church, apostolic and universal. I believe in the Christian Church, the true teacher, both of the individual and of all men, that it is the steward of divine graces and the light in our temple pilgrimage to God and salvation. I believe in the necessity of hearing the Word of God and the receiving of the Holy Sacraments. I believe that all people, as children of God, are equal. I believe that all people have equal right to existence, but I also believe that all people have sacred obligations before God, themselves, and humanity. I believe in the righteousness of God, in a future life beyond the grave, in immortality, eternal happiness, and in union with God of all people, of all races and ages. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Mighty your arm, strong your hand, your right hand is ever exalted. Justice and judgment are the foundation of your throne. Love and loyalty march before you. Blessed the ones who know you, Lord, who walk in the radiance of your countenance. We receive from your most sacred hand, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust as did the apostles and disciples of your Son and our Savior, when he said to them, I myself am the bread of life, and he eats of this bread you shall live forever. Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God.
forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. You have called us to love one another, demonstrating harmony among brothers and sisters and friendship among neighbors. Your word tells us that everyone who loves is begotten of you and knows you. Through the love that we have for one another, all will know that we are your disciples. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, your Son, and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers in the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. All present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule, and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those, here the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life in his most precious blood. Just as they believed, professed, and united with you, through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, from the temple of messianic life, of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those whom he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him, we will come to him, and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst.
After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you." In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, mindful, Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those during life straying from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your faithful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
yeah.
And by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our days, supported by the help of your mercy, may we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom. You live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Shall I return unto the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? And I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. God. Thank you. and the blood of Christ. The body 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 and the blood of Christ. The body.
Let us pray.
Almighty and eternal God, our most merciful Father, grant that as we benefit from the grace received in this holy sacrament of the Mass, that we may follow your holy will as we continue to build our holy church. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lo, the sacrifice is offered.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.